is the Holy Spirit plain. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Praise God. Father, we thank you for our time together in the Word. Thank you for the Holy Spirit, who is our God, who is our teacher, who is the undergirder of our lives, the great and mighty Paracletos that comes to remind us and to bring us back into all that Jesus taught, to reveal to us the Word of God so that we can walk in harmony with the purposes and plans of the Father. Hallelujah. That we can walk as who we are in Christ through the redemptive work of Jesus. We thank you this morning that as we unveil the Scriptures, that the Spirit of God is on the hearts of the hearer and the listener, bringing revelation, bringing understanding, teaching. And we yield ourselves to His guidance, to His counsel, to His direction in Jesus' name. And everyone agree with that by saying, amen, amen. All right, let's go ahead. We're going to go back and read our foundation text. Last week we started along this lines. We did go off on some different directions. Everybody said different directions. Hallelujah, which is nothing unusual for me. Y'all missed a really, really, really good opportunity to say amen. Okay, hallelujah. You know, or that's the truth, or Lord help us, amen. Whatever. All right. Galatians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14 says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, because it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. What? That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through faith, or through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Now, last week we did cover this. We said that, you know, a lot of people say, well, these things were for the Jews, and the redemption from the curse was for the Jews. But Paul wrote and said that it was for the church, that it was on the church. The Gentiles were to receive the promise of the blessing of Abraham through Jesus Christ. God's opened up a way for us to receive the blessing of Abraham. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. And so we're excited about that. And we know, let's look over in Hebrews 6, 13 and 14, where we read last week, for when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself. There was no, listen, if God was going to swear something with an oath, he couldn't find anybody else higher than himself. Amen. He is the supreme being of all things. There is none higher. Okay? Hallelujah. Saying, surely I will bless thee and bless thee, and multiplying I will multiply thee. The Weymouth translation for verse 14 says, I will bless you and bless you, or assuredly I will bless you and bless you. I will increase you and increase you. So we said last week that the blessing of Abraham is the blessing of blessing and of increase. Okay? And so blessing, we thank God for blessing. How many are glad we can be blessed? Anybody don't like being blessed? Listen, like we said, I think we said this last week, that commercial where the guy comes in and says, hey, I'm going to give you a raise, and he says, thanks, but I don't want it. You know, they put the bowl of food down in front of the dog, and he just pushes it away. No, we like being blessed. Can you say amen? Amen. Are you here? Amen. Anybody here? Everybody else going home? And the word we said last week, blessed, comes from the Greek eulogio, and it means to bless or to invoke a benediction upon or to prosper. Okay? And so God has a blessing. The blessing of Abraham is the blessing of prosperity and increase. So let me say, prosperity is not limited to money. Now we go straight to the money, but I tell you, there's greater prosperity than finances. As a matter of fact, according to the third book of John, the second verse, beloved, I pray above, now King James uses the word wish, but really better to say I pray. I pray above all things that you prosper and be in health, even or in correspondence or in relationship to how your soul prospers. Amen. What is soul prosperity? For the believer, it's the renewal of the mind. Amen. Having the mind of Christ, thinking like God. Now let me say this. Having the mind of Christ, thinking like God, will take away selfishness out of your prosperity financially. Amen. Amen. I thought I heard a choir out here singing amen. Yeah, brother, right out there. Some geese out there going, amen. Because you sure didn't say it. Come on now. The soul prosperity is a mind renewed to the Word of God, putting on the mind of Christ, having in your thought life where you think like God thinks. Now see, when you begin to think that way, then the selfishness that we've seen in the excess, see, listen, you could teach the Bible and people can run off the deep end with it. And then you can have some people who teach it off the deep end. And then the people really go off the deep end with it. Are you here? We took a bad rap in the charismatic word of faith circles on prosperity because we had people who were beginning to miss. We talked about this last week, and I'm not going to cover all that. But we got where it was about me. It was about me having money. It was about me being rich. It was about me, you know, getting Robin Leach to come by my house and me appearing on the Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. Okay, you know, my $20 million yacht. I got a chateau on the along the Champs Elysees in Paris. Gag a maggot. Anyway, if it'll gag a maggot, it'll gag anything. All right. So we have this mindset that, you know, if we teach prosperity, then we're a bunch of money-grubbing dogs, and it's all about us, and et cetera, and so forth. But the reality is that prosperity is for humanity. Come on in, folks. We'll just have you. You know, grab a seat there. Grab a seat there. We're glad to have you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. So here we are. So the Bible gives us the balance to it. You see, when we take the Word of God and read the whole counsel of the Word of God, then we don't have to balance the Word of God. The Word of God will balance itself. Are y'all here? You gone home? See, the Word of God will take care of fixing stuff if we'll take the whole counsel of the whole Word. And so, you know, where the Word of God says, where John says and writes, you know, it says, I pray above all things that you prosper. See, yeah, God wants you to have prosperity. And He wants you to have financial prosperity. Don't. I heard one preacher say one time, you know, that God wants some Christians to suffer and others to have money, you know, and He wants to work out compassion in the rich folks by having poor folks. No, God wants everybody to be blessed, you know. And then you get these people who make all these millions of dollars off the church. And they run around talking about how God just wants them to be blessed like that so that they can, you know, they can do this. And they're living lavish lifestyles. I'm sorry. The Word of God's for the whole church. It's not for certain elect ones to get blessed and others not to get blessed. Okay? You know, and some of those same folks come out and talk about how you're supposed to be poor and that's what God's working in your life. And while they're sitting over there with their, you know, Bentley and their 7-car garage. Hello? And their $20 million house. Well, I'm sorry. I don't believe God works in a way where He's just going to let one guy hoard up all this wealth so that he can be writing books to the church while everybody else is trying to figure out how, writing books about how they're supposed to suffer while they're making money on your suffering. Right. Now, beloved, I pray above all things that you prosper and be in health. But here is the balance to it. As your soul prospers. You see, when the mind is renewed to the Word of God, and we put on the mind of Christ. Remember, Paul said that, you know, that I have not seen, ear hath not heard, neither has into the heart of man the things which God's revealed to them. Then he goes on down and says, goes on down below that and says this, but ye have the mind of Christ. See, it is the mind of Christ. It is the renewed mind. It is the mind that has the Word of God engrafted in it that saves or separates or restores your soul. Sozo. It brings it back to the place it needs to be that now governs prosperity coming into your life, how you handle it. Amen. See, the believer whose mind has been renewed with the Word of God, not just renewed to get rich, renewed to the purpose of prosperity, renewed to how to handle that which God entrusts. We are stewards over the treasures that God entrusts to us. Amen. See, we have a great example. And we'll probably read these scriptures, you know, when we get to them. And is anybody in here warm besides me? I love you. I've wore my coat. I am now taking it off. All right? Hallelujah. I came dignified. I'm going to de-dignify right now. All right. I'm not taking off the tie. All right. All right. See, we have the example. Remember, God spoke to Abram and said, get thee out of thy country, out of thy father's house, away from thy kindred, and go to a place that I will show thee. So Abraham loads up his wife and his family and his stuff and takes Lot. He wasn't supposed to take Lot. Lot was not supposed to be on the trip. Why? Because Lot didn't have the right heart. We know that. Because later on they get down there and they get down the valley near Sodom and Gomorrah and they're just exploding with blessing. Why? Because the blessing of Abraham's coming on Abraham. I'm going to take a... y'all remember that. Lot and Abraham. That's your job. You will not let me forget. I'm talking about Lot and Abraham and what happened. Tree her out. All right. Ministers. You go off to Tulsa and go sit at Rhema. You go sit under certain places where big ministries have a tremendous influence because of the anointing on them. And then you think you're going to go out and start a church down the road. And what you're doing is you're getting blessed because you're under the umbrella of that ministry you've been sitting under. You think you're something. You ain't all that. Take it and go to Kalamazoo or go out in the boonies somewhere where the name of the city is on one side of the pole and on the other side. Are you know what I'm talking about? There's little crossroads out there. We got a place down where my high school was at Littlefield. Littlefield was 4 inches thick. Because on one side it said Littlefield, and on the other side it said Littlefield. All right? Down there where D.H. Conley is, you got Hollywood's Crossroads. See, we want to take something and operate under somebody else's instead of getting with God and getting our own. Getting with God, he wants to do it. Listen, I understand being under ministry. I understand being under the anointing. But when we try to operate and use that to our benefit without... And use it right there in that same place instead of going out and using it somewhere else, I think it's wrong. You get people come up in churches, they become assistant pastors or whatever, and they run down the road and split the church and go start another church. And they take all those people that God had placed in there or whatever, take them down the road with them. That's not God. You're operating under Abraham's blessing, but you're acting like Lot. But that, can I get a holy grunt? Amen. Let's go to Genesis 13. Because we kind of went down here last week, but we got so off in some different directions last week, we want to kind of pull us back and refocus and get back in our groove here. And Abraham went up out of Egypt, or Abram, not Abraham, but Abram, he's still Abram at this point. Went up out of Egypt, he and his wife, and all that he had, and Lot with him into the south. Now, God didn't say bring Lot, he brought Lot. Abram was very rich in cattle and silver and gold. He went on his journeys from the south unto Bethel, unto the place of the tent, where his tent had been the beginning between Bethel and Hai, unto the place of the altar which he had made there at first, and there Abram called on the name of the Lord. And Lot also, which went with Abram, had flocks and herds and tents, and the land was not able to bear them. Think about the blessing of a man that's so great the land can't handle it. You got too much. We run around talking about how God wants you to not have enough and how God's trying to make you poor. One of the old sayings in the church was about the preachers, Lord, you keep them humble, we'll keep them poor. Now listen, ministers, We've come way past that because now you got ministers over there thinking they're supposed to rape the people and live like a Hollywood movie star. Come on now. See, we can't get in the, people don't want to get in the middle of the road. They want to get one side of the. Well, we preachers are owed all this back pay. No, you're not. You ain't owed squats. You're called to serve the Lord, and in serving the Lord, you're serving His people. It ain't about you. I said it ain't about the minister. It's about carrying out the purpose of God to minister to people and to help them fulfill their purpose and destiny in life. Amen. So stop raping the congregation and raping the people so that because you feel like you're owed something. I'm glad it ain't your preacher. So they'd probably shoot me with a knife. I mean, a blow dart gun or something with poison on it. The land was not able to bear them that they dwell together, for their substance was great, so they could not dwell together. And there was strife. That's the way I said. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's cattle and the herdmen of Lot's cattle and the Canaanite and the Perizzite dwelling in the land. Man, not only had Abram and Lot showed up, you had people who were already there who they couldn't get their stuff taken care of because Abraham and Lot showed up and they were scavenging the land with all their herds. It just wasn't enough to bear them. And strife arose. Can you imagine? See, everybody thinks if you get enough stuff, you won't be upset about anything. Yeah, we got more than enough. Oh, we're blessed. We won't ever have any problems. You get too much, now you start fighting with everybody over having too much. Why? Because human nature is human nature. If you don't renew yourself to the things of God and get the right heart and keep the right heart, you'll fall right back in. No matter where you are, you'll let that human nature come out, and it's always selfish. I said it's always selfish. Y'all hear you gone home. I heard, I was with a minister one time who was a chaplain. It was Van Crouch. And he was a chaplain to the Chicago Cubs, the Chicago Bears, and somebody else. He was a scout for the Dallas Cowboys. But he was a minister, you know. But he came to me one time, we were in the car when he was here ministering, and we were riding. He said, and he gave me this figure, X number percent of NBA basketball players retire bankrupt. Really? Yep. Now some of that's changed because you've got some people who've realized that some of the players, some of the like a Michael Jordan and stuff, who started mentoring programs, who started trying to help these kids who are coming in. But see, he said, "Oh yeah, all we're doing is you're taking a kid, and you know, NBA is primarily has a large propensity of kids who are coming out of inner city, impoverished areas, and their dream is to get to the NBA and to make the money and to get out of all that mess. But what happens? You got agents." Little leashy bloodsuckers, and everybody in the world's there trying to take their money. And what happens is they just elevate their lifestyle to match the income. So whereas before they may be having to get food stamps to go get a little bit of food to live off of, and they spend everything they had. When they get all that money, they just raise it up. And so instead of using food stamps, now they're ordering lobster flown in from wherever. And they're not driving, they're not riding around in a car that's got, bolts all over it, trying to hold it together with baling wire, trying to keep the fenders from falling off. They're driving around in the most expensive car on the market. What did they do? They went from driving a car that wasn't worth $1,300 to one that's $1.3 million. At least, yeah. And they're just spending that money, and they raise their lifestyle to match it. Why? Because you didn't change the person. All you did was put, what? And because they didn't change, the habits of how they handled money only escalated in proportion to the money. It didn't change. They didn't change. And so after their career's over and the $10 million plus ain't coming in every year, all of a sudden, they use it all up. Because they've been living this lifestyle and they haven't changed them. That's what the mentoring programs are about, to try to help them understand these things and help them make better decisions financially. Which you have to do. Because these people are just going to blood suck them. And when they're done and their career's over, you can't even find those guys who were there, who were their best friends and all that stuff. They're nothing but little pawns in the gladiators. They're just gladiators. And as long as they're good, they're good. But as soon as they're no good, they're just, I don't even know who you are. Well, see, this is what happens in the church. We start teaching people prosperity. You get a lot of people who've been struggling. All of a sudden, I'm going to believe God. I'm going to give to that preacher and get a thousandfold return today. And all of a sudden, they got some money coming in, but they don't get their mind renewed. So now they just start being excessive with the money and not dealing with it with the right renewed mind. Or, as in this case, you get strife. The land can't bear them. Now they're ticked off and fighting. Instead of going around rejoicing, we got so much stuff, we don't know what to do with it. They're fighting. Come on now. Hallelujah. And Abram said to Lot, "Let there be no strife." Now see what? You got the mature guy showing up. "I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my herdmen and your herdmen, for we are brethren. Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If you will take the left hand, then I will go to the right. If you take the part to the right hand, I'll take the left. Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plains of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, that thou comest to Zoar. And Lot chose all the plain of Jordan. Then Lot journeyed east and separated themselves from one from another. Now, what he did, he took the best land. You see? See, when you don't understand how you got there. See, Abram didn't say, it doesn't matter. Why? Because he knew who he served. I'll take whatever land because he's going to take care of me. He wasn't uptight. Take whatever you want. Lot's thinking, man. See, Lot's been in on this deal, getting in on the overflow, and now he's going to run over to Sodom, near Sodom, and set up camp. Not realizing he's not ready for it. Hello. We got people who think that they can minister in certain places and they can't. They're not equipped. You got to be equipped to minister in certain places. Hello. You can minister effectively on the outside as you can inside. That went over big. Thank you for your enthusiasm. Are you here? Now, the Bible says Jesus ate with the publicans and sinners. It didn't say he was down in the drug in the bar drinking with them. Come on, guys. I need to hear the amen out there because I'm not getting it in here again. And Abram dwelled in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent towards Sodom. He kept getting closer and closer. But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly. And the Lord said to Abram, after Lot has separated from him, said, lift up thine eyes. Now, wait a second now. Because see here, they're coming along. But see, the blessing's not on Lot. See, when we're operating out from under something, we need to recognize what it is. The blessing was on Abraham. Lift up your eyes and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. Lift up your eyes and look. From the place where you now stand, north, south, east, and west, I've given you the land. Fruitful I will make thee, and thy seed after thee. In their generations I'll bless exceedingly. I'm of the seed of Abraham. That's where David Ingalls got the song, right here. Okay? Came right out of this verse. Didn't know that, did you? Huh? You got it. All right. For all the land thou seest will I give thee, and to thy seed after thee, and I'll make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then the man thy seed shall be numbered. Arise, walk through the land, the length of it, the breadth of it, for I'll give it to thee. And Abraham removed his tent and came into the plain of Mamre and to Hebron and built an altar unto the Lord. Lot went over to Sodom. Now it says later, remember when God comes down to judge Sodom and Gomorrah, and he says, will I hide this thing that I do from Abraham, my friend? Now the word friend in that language, in Eastern languages, meant blood covenant partner. Will I hide this thing? And he came down, and the Bible said this. It said that Lot had vexed his righteous soul daily. See, when we don't renew our mind to the Word of God, we just want to live in the blessings. In other words, we want the prosperity. I pray that you prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. See, John was putting a parameter on them getting the wealth. You've got to renew your mind to the Word of God. You have to let the mind of Christ function in you so that it governs your thinking and keeps selfishness out and keeps self, all about me out. My wife chaperoned a field trip for Shannon's grade when Shannon was in high school. And she came up, she said, honey, you ain't gonna believe it. One of the girls came out, she had a pair of pajama pants, and all over the pajama pants it said, it's all about me, it's all about me, it's all about me, it's all about me. And of course you could look at the kid and realize it was all about them. You know? No, it's not all about you. You getting prosperity is not about you getting, you know, million-dollar automobiles. It's not about having six houses. It's not about having a private jet. Hello? Well, there's nothing wrong with me having a private jet. If there is an absolute need for it, no. But just to blow $20 million just so you can say you have it, so you can go in and tell everybody that I got a private jet, is stupid. Did you know all the corporate guys are getting rid of their private jets and leasing them? Hello? And you know what the joke we came, the kind of the joke was? Sell it to one of them prosperity preachers. They're buying them like crazy. Now you got a lot of guys say, see, that means we're getting there. No, see, they realized there was no need to have that kind of expense. It was foolish to have that kind of expense. And so they started getting rid of them because it was being foolish. They were not being good stewards of the corporation's money. Hello? And so they started leasing. They get to ride the private jet. They get a pilot. They get, you know, but they didn't have that expense that was sitting there in it. Hello? Okay. It's not about you. I remember back when we used to have the satellite things, where they had the satellite things, and the guy that was running them, he had the power tie of the month. The next month after he came out with his tie on, that was the power tie. And all everybody else had to go get that tie. They all had a power tie. Oh, bless her heart. Yes. That's okay, baby. It's okay, baby. It's all right. It'll be all right. Yeah. That's okay. We've all had them when they're that age. I had one we couldn't even go to restaurants with after they got to a certain age because they would just make so much noise you couldn't eat. There's some days I still can't take him. No, I'm just kidding. He makes so much noise in a restaurant. I mean, he would just... And we're the kind of parents, we're not going to sit there and let every other table listen to your screaming youngin'. So one of us walk out in the foyer or walk out and let everybody else eat until, and we just say, forget it, we're going home. We ain't going out anymore. Not until he shuts up. That hadn't happened yet. Praise the Lord. And so we have this example of Lot and Abraham. Glad I didn't need your help. And here you have Lot, who's not really getting his, he's not thinking along the lines of God. He moves to the city, gets over there near all the sinful stuff. He had to know what was over there. And he pitched his tent up there, and then and you know what he ends up doing? He moves into the city. See, if you don't renew your mind to the Word of God and let soul prosperity take prevalence in your life so that when prosperity comes, you can deal with it properly, you'll become selfish, self-centered, and misuse what God blesses you with. It's not God's withholding it from you. It's God wants you to handle it right. God wants you blessed. John said he wants you to have prosperity. But in relationship to the soul prosperity, the renewing of the mind, thinking like Christ, having a mind that looks at stuff the way God looks at it. And it's not, listen, we could take stuff and take it to some extremes. You know, God always looks at it. He wants everybody filthy rich or righteously rich and, you know, having this and having that. And then they're his children, all the wealth of the sinners laid up for the just. And we're all going to have so much money you can't even think straight. And that's the problem. When you can't think straight, you're not going to handle it straight. So what do we do? God wants you to prosper. God wants the blessing of Abraham, which is prosperity and increase in your life. Jesus paid the price to purchase it for you. But the governing parameter is having your mind renewed so that you think like Christ, so that when that money is sitting in your hand, it's sitting in your bank account, it's not you don't use it to be lascivious. God wants you. Listen, God doesn't care if you have nice cars. God doesn't care if you have nice clothes. Hello? But I can tell you something. If I wear a $10,000 hand tailored suit, that's not going to help the guy who don't have anything have an image of getting better. It's not my suit that breaks the yoke. It is the anointing that destroys the yoke of bondage. It is the light of the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, Peter and John showed up at the temple one day, looked down at the guy who was impotent in his feet from his mother's womb, and they said, "Silver and gold have I none." They didn't have all that. They didn't have any money that day. Didn't mean they were broke. They just had any money on them. But they said, "Such as I have, give I thee. Arise in the name of Jesus and walk." And immediately he received strength and went walking, leaping, and praising God into the temple. Hello? I said, hello? See, it wouldn't matter if they showed up in their power robe. They wore robes. Come on, guys, that's a joke. Lighten up with me here. Get into the flow just a little bit, all right? Hallelujah. He could have had on his power shawl. Could have had on designer sandals. And that wouldn't have got that guy healed. Are you here? I said, are you here? So it's not that God doesn't want you to have nice things, but stop thinking that that's what's going to impress people. I'm going to tell you something. You can take some country bumpkin who kind of has broken English or bad southern drawl English, or you can take somebody from the ghetto who has, a ghetto talk, and you can bring them in. But if they get born again, feel the life of God, and the anointing of God's on them, what they can speak into people who are very articulate. We're very educated, but it's the anointing that destroys you. I'm not saying just act dumb, just be dumb. But I am telling you, we got to stop depending on things and carnal ideas of how to reach people and let the anointing of God be the things that destroys yokes in people's lives. Yes, God wants you blessed. God wants the blessing of Abraham coming on you. But let your mind be renewed so that you can handle it aright. So that you don't pitch your tent to Sodom. You pitch it out here in the plains and the bad land, and you still prosper. Because your eye and your heart's on God. It costs Lot everything. It cost him his wife. She was turned into a pillar of salt. He got so vexed. Listen, what kind of dipstick jerk father offers his daughters to a mob to rape them? I'm the kind of father that you came to my house and wanted to do that. You'd be hearing shkum-chinkum. Hello? I don't know how to use it, but I'd learn. There's one in my house. There's a pump shotgun, and it's Nathan's, but I'll flat out figure out how to use it. Now, how does this work? Boom! Oh, that's how it works. Anybody else? I think I got it down now. But they came to Lot's house because the angels were there, and they were perverted people. They wanted to have sex with angels. It's a homosexual city. Just don't even play games with it, folks. It was a homosexual city. God was going to destroy it because of it. And Lot comes out and says, "Take my daughters instead. You imbecile. If they're angels from heaven, you think they could take care of themselves?" Hello? I said, hello? He was so vexed, he offered his daughters to a mob to rape and do anything they wanted to with sexually. You see, his mind, he got that prosperity, he didn't get his mind renewed. His mind wasn't in communion with God. It became vexed. I said it became vexed. And because he was vexed, he couldn't think straight. And he didn't handle what God had entrusted him with right. That's why when we start talking about you having the blessing of Abraham and blessings coming on you, it is so important that you keep your heart right with the Word of God. Keep your thinking right with the Word of God. So that you're not out here and the day you get $1 million, you're out there with, Pastor, we'll see you next. When the money runs out, we'll be back. I'm going to give you $10,000. I'm going to give a big offering, Pastor. I'm going to give you $10,000. You got $1 million, it's $100,000, buddy. That's a tithe. Are you here? Not 10. Well, that's the biggest gift I've ever given. No. You're $90,000 hold robbing God. See, when you think right, all you can think about is blessing. I said, when you think right, y'all, you can think of it as being a blessing. And I can become a blessing. Abraham let Lot take wherever he wanted to avoid strife because he knew his God would take care of him. Hello? Hallelujah. And so, we have again expended a lot of our time, and I haven't gotten far. All right. Genesis chapter 14. We go down here. Nations all went to war. Look down in verse 23 of Genesis 14. We're not going to read this whole, all this. We'll pick up around verse 18. How about that? Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine. And he was a priest of the Most High God. He blessed him and said, blessed be Abram of the Most High God, a possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which has delivered thine enemies into thy hand. And he gave him tithes of all. Abraham gave to Melchizedek tithes of all. And the king of Sodom said unto Abram, give me the persons and take the goods to thyself. And Abram said to the king of Sodom, I will lift up my hand unto the Lord, the Most High, the possessor of heaven and earth. And I will not take from a thread even to a shoe latchet. And that I will not take anything that is thine, lest thou shouldest say, I have made Abraham rich. Save only or accept only that which the young men have eaten and the portion of the men which went with me, Amar, Eshcol, and Mamre, let them take their portion. In other words, Abram says, I am not going to let you go around and brag and tell everybody you made me rich. Because I'm where I am because of God. I'm not taking the spoils of war. God let him take the spoils of war in certain cases. But in this case, Abram was going to maintain his integrity that it was God who had blessed him. And in this particular case, the king, the king of Sodom is not a really good guy. All right? He understood that to keep my integrity, I'm going to say the Lord's blessed me. Why? Because when we come along now, let me tell you something. You can't go around and start saying, my hand hath gotten me this. See, you can get so busy working so hard, doing so many things, you start thinking you're doing it all. Now, how many of you ever sat down lately and kind of tried to figure out where you are and if you should really be able to be there? I was talking with my national director the other day. I said, I'll be really honest with you. I said, we shouldn't be here right now. I'm talking about financially. We shouldn't be standing right now. As far as laying it all out and doing, as far as the natural is concerned, there's no reason we are here. There's no reason. I can't find a place there that says, yeah, this is why you were able to do this. But we're still here. Because God takes care of us. God undergirds us. And even when it looks the worst that it could possibly look, God's still God. Amen. Hallelujah. I can't go say, well, so-and-so gave $50,000 to the church. Be nice, but they hadn't. Hello? Sometimes I just like to have $500. Yeah, sometimes, we're all human. We like to have it in big lump sums. Yeah. Yes, sir, baby, I'd love to have the whole thing right now. Woo, glory to God. Every time it looked like we weren't going to make it to the next place, God. I said, God. Right when it looks like there's no more turnips to get the blood out of. Remember that? Can't squeeze the turnip blood out of a turnip. Yeah, sometimes you think I got to put it in some kind of press and get something out of it. But God said, I will bless you and bless you. I'll prosper you. Sometimes, the world tells us prosperity is one thing. God sometimes says prosperity is, payday's coming. It don't always come when you think it's going to come. Hello? Sometimes it shows up when you weren't looking for it, and sometimes it ain't there when you need it, or you think you need it. You get just enough to get by. That's not lack of faith preaching. There's going to be places you stand in that you have to stand by faith and stand your ground. And why? Because sometimes standing your ground and winning there will empower you to stand in a different place at a higher level. There are times you just have to, you have to win the battle in this place to bear up under the weight of the calling to the next higher place. You have to win the battle. You have to win. You have to win by faith. And you can't go under. So you're the head, not the tail. Above only, not beneath. You go over, not under. Hello? We'd all like to go out in our backyard and strike oil. I would. I'll set up a rig right there. We're going choon, to choon, and all night long. And I'm just going cha-ching, 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 cha-ching. Go dig up an emerald in your backyard, biggest emerald on the East Coast. That's what happened at the Mennonite. That's where that guy found that emerald. Yeah, digging around the back, digging around the ground, found the biggest emerald anywhere. The Mennonite mine, they put it on display at the Smithsonian. Huh? Hidnight. I said Hidnight. Put it on display at the Smithsonian occasionally. Yeah. They had Saturday shotguns. Keep people from coming and stealing. Okay. So God, he said, I'll not take anything because I'm not going to have to say that any man made Abraham rich. Just because somebody shows up and it looks like the answer, it might not be the answer. And you got to ask yourself, what have I got to pay? What's the cost of this answer? I've shared this before. We had somebody in the church at one time, and they came to me and said, well, I got this opportunity. Well, what's the opportunity? Well, we're stocking vending machines. Okay, you know, candy bars, you know, soft drinks and stuff. No, cigarette vending machines. Oh, really? Yeah. Got an opportunity to make a lot of money. We're going to tithe on it. Oh, really? Okay. What price are you going to pay to have that? You know, so, but I asked him, I said, okay, fine. Tell you, I want you to do something. Go ahead and try doing it. See, God will give you wisdom. I said, God will give you wisdom. I said, you go ahead and try doing it. But here, promise me. When you open up that vending machine, and open up and swing the door open, and you get all them cartons of cigarettes out, and you're getting ready to stick them in there, I say, hold them up to the Lord. Say, Lord, I fill this vending machine to your glory and to your honor so that we can give the tithe to the church. I said, and then go ahead and do it. They came back the next week. I say what you mean, Pastor. What? Play dumb. Yeah. What? I couldn't do it. Could do what? I couldn't fill that machine and say I'm giving glory to God by doing it. Oh, okay. See, if I told them you better not do it, sin, or you're being sinful, or they could have got mad with me because I told them they can't do it. Hello? I said, hello? But when they've tried it, when they do it, it's like Brother Hagin told that woman one time. She said, I'd get saved, but I can't give up dancing. She liked to go out and dance in the clubs and stuff. He said, go ahead and give your heart to the Lord and then dance as much as you want to. That's what he told her. Dance as much as you want to. She came back the next week, gave her heart to the Lord, came back the next week. I see what you mean. He said, what? She said, the want to's gone. The want to's gone. Okay? Dance as much as you want to, but the want to left. Amen? See, God wants us to honor Him in everything we do. He wants us to be good stewards over the prosperity He gives us. He wants to renew our minds so that we think like Him. And we handle it the way He does. And then we look and we honor Him. Abram took the bad place, and even when they had opportunity to take great spoil, he said, no, I'm not going to say it. I haven't said that Abraham made you rich, that any man made Abraham rich. People, the devil will send answers to what you need that are not from God so that you have to pay the price for what you took. When if you'll wait on the Lord and you have your mind on Him, when the answer comes, remember this, the Bible says this, God causes us to get the power, gives us the power to get wealth and adds no sorrow therewith. You can get wealth and have sorrow. That's not biblical prosperity. That's not Bible prosperity. If your wealth is causing you to lose your family and to lose your kids and to lose your life and to live the world, it's not Bible prosperity. Hello? He has no sorrow therewith. Now, we know the Kennedys. They have excessive amounts of money. They don't pay hardly any taxes because they live off an estate. They just happen to live in the house that the estate money pays for. But has that family had sorrow? Now, it's pretty well known that the money came from bootleg liquor during Prohibition. Got extremely rich. Then the money was invested into estates, into trust funds where it's all protected from taxes. Hello? Assassinated. Daughter born with a mental problem. They tried some kind of lobotomy or something and it really messed her up. Drugs. Edward Kennedy was probably not a really good person. He just, chappaquiddick. But see, money can get you out of a lot of stuff. But there's not been blessing there. Robert or John F. Jr. was it killed in the plane crash? There's been a lot of sorrow with that money. That's not the blessing of the Lord. Oh, they got lots of money. But what good is the money if you got sorrow? Howard Hughes at this time was the richest man in the world, and he was an absolute nutcase. He lived in a sterile environment because he thought he was going to get germs. What kind of life is that? You got all this money, you can't go out and can't enjoy the planet because you got to live in a sterile, filtered environment with everybody wearing gloves. You can't have people coming in. They got to wear masks and all this kind of stuff because you can't be around them. What kind of life is that? Now, God wants you blessed, but no sorrow. Well, how do we not have sorrow? We make good decisions. We make godly decisions. We live a godly life. We don't pitch our tent to Sodom. So we don't pitch our tent to Sodom because it'll vex you and it'll cost you. So now we got all that out of the way. We're going to move into the blessing of Abraham next week. Because God wants you to have blessing. But I am telling you, if you renew your mind to the Word of God and have the mind of Christ, then you'll know what to do with it in a way that's blessed, that'll bless instead of rob. I know people right now, if they were in the lottery tomorrow, you wouldn't see them in church again for 10 years. And they might see you if they stop in town to just come by and take you out to lunch or something. But they're gone. To do what? Beep the horn at you as they ride by. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for this word. We thank you that we are challenged to renew our minds to the Word of God, so that we can be good stewards over the things of God, that we walk uprightly before you and honor you in everything we set our hand to, that the Lord is blessed by our attitudes and by our actions, and in turn, people are blessed and ministered to in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, we lay hands on these prayer cloths. We thank you that the anointing of God goes into them. Even you wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. You bring special miracles now through us. They put their hands on these claws, and they're taken to the sick and to the infirm. We think that the evil spirits go out of them, and they're they're healed and made whole from the top of their heads to the soles of their feet. And Father, there be those here that we don't have prayer claws for, that they're at home. We speak over their bodies. We thank you that the healer goes by, the healer touches them, and the anointing of God sets them free, and they're made every whit whole in Jesus' name.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.